This is the Rainbow Aviation video channel, and I'm your host, Brian Carpenter. In today's episode, we're going to be taking a look at a low-cost way for all of you aircraft builders to manufacture your own aluminum hydroformed parts. This is a companion video for the Technically Speaking article published in the May 2016 Sport Aviation magazine. We are often looking for methods for creating parts on our experimental aircraft that replicate the professionalism of factory-built aircraft. The biggest stumbling block is usually the cost of setup for fancy tooling and machinery. Yet you might be surprised at what you can accomplish in your own small workshop. In fact, many of the greatest ideas in aviation originated from small workshops like yours. Those very professional-looking stamped aluminum parts are a great example. The hydroforming machines that are used to manufacture these parts can cost well over $100,000. In this video, we're going to take a look at some of the options for you to make your very own professional-looking hydroform parts using equipment that you probably already have in your shop. We have for many years now been utilizing a simple tool that we built in our shop for making small, hydroformed parts. Well, not really hydroformed parts, but rather parts that could have been hydroformed. By definition, hydroforming is a process using high-pressure fluid to force a malleable metal over the top of a metal die, resulting in a formed metal component. Rather than using a fluid to deform the aluminum parts, we're going to be using a block of rubber contained within a steel box, pressed over the top of a die to form our metal components. And to provide pressure necessary to cause the rubber to flow like a liquid, we're going to use a simple 20-ton Harbor Freight hydraulic press. First of all, making this box. This is where many people get a little overambitious. The amount of pressure necessary to cause the rubber to flow like a liquid is quite substantial. Let's do the math. Our box is 11 by 11 inside dimension. That's approximately 120 square inches. The force available on our press is 40,000 pounds. 40,000 divided by 120 square inches equals 333 psi, or pounds per square inch. That is about the minimum force necessary for conducting this hydroforming process. Normally, the parts do not consume the entire area of the box, and thus the amount of initial force over the die is greater. As the parts get bigger, the amount of forming force gets distributed. Some of the manufacturers creating ribs use the hydroforming process without completely bending the flanges on the rib. Even if the total force available is not sufficient to bend the flanges 90 degrees, you can still use the hydroforming process to initiate the bend on the edge of a rib flange. Even if the flange is only bent about 30 degrees, it provides an initial shape that will allow us to finish the flanges on the rib using a hand bending tool and a metal shrinking tool or a pair of fluting pliers to finish the shaping of the flange. This is actually a preferred method when you're working with flanges into a part with a smaller radius. The most common question is, what type of rubber should I be using? And of course the answer is, it depends. The harder the durometer of rubber, the more definition you will achieve on your final product. However, it becomes harder for the rubber to flow, resulting in higher required pressures. A good starting place would be a durometer of a Shore 40A to a Shore 60A. To give you an idea of the relationship of this hardness, Shore 20 would be that similar to a rubber band, and Shore 60A would be about as hard as a car tire tread. Normally, the highest cost of making your own forming machine is the cost of this rubber blank. Because of this, you may want to see if you can find a piece of surplus rubber big enough to manufacture your part before you begin manufacturing your box. Then build your forming box to fit the piece of rubber. Keep in mind that even if you can't find a 2-inch piece of rubber, several pieces of a lesser thickness will also suffice. Our 2-inch block we're using is actually two pieces of 1-inch thick neoprene rubber glued together. Next, making the dies. There are many ways that we can manufacture dies for the use in forming aluminum. Even the use of MDF, medium density fiberboard, this is the stuff you can buy at Home Depot, will work very well. The downside is that MDF won't last as long as the other materials that we might want to use. They just simply can't withstand the higher pressures. However, if all you're going to do is manufacture, say, a dozen parts, the MDF may be more than adequate for your task. Of course, steel and aluminum parts will work very well. They hold up well and last for as many parts as you want to make. The downside for these materials is that they require specialized equipment for the machining of the die, and especially if they're very complex. Our favorite material for manufacturing dies is corian. Corian is an acrylic polymer that is commonly used in the manufacturing of kitchen countertops. The corian material is very easy to machine and manipulate with both machine and hand tools. It can be cut with a table saw or a bandsaw, and it can be sanded, filed, and drilled very easily. It's also very durable. We have used corian for making dies where we need to form up to or even more than 100 pieces. Although corian is very expensive if you're purchasing it outright, we find that we can purchase scrap corian material from countertop companies for pennies on the dollar. Every countertop sink cutout is simply scrap material, and ironically, it's also the largest size piece that we can typically use in making a die for our small forming machine. So let's get on to the forming process. There are quite a few tricks that will bridge the gap between frustration and success. To start with, knowing your material is very important. Because of the high tensile strength of 2024 T3 aluminum, forming this material can be quite tricky. Keep in mind that during the forming process, the material will have to stretch and compress depending on the shape of the die. Compound curves become more difficult than simple bends, and sometimes adding special features into the die to absorb the tension and compression within the metal will make the forming process more successful. Using an aluminum that is annealed like 2024-0 is much easier to form, but it will require heat treatment after the forming process in order to retain the strength. Although not as strong as 2024 T3, 6061 T6 aluminum can compress and stretch around a die a little bit better when you're trying to get more aggressive with your forming process. When you get very aggressive with the shape of the die, you're relegated to forming with an annealed material and then heat treating after the final product. This shows an example of 2024 T3 aluminum being aggressively formed at about 2000 PSI, stretching the aluminum to the point of cracking. Another trick that we find very useful is using lemon pledge as a lubricant. If the parts and the rubber are dry during the forming process, the rubber will grab the metal and force extra stress into the aluminum. By using a lubricant, the rubber will slide and move easily, preventing the pulling and tugging on the aluminum. The next trick that we find helpful is utilizing sacrificial rubber in addition to the rubber of our forming block. We use old inner tubes cut into small squares that will fit inside the forming box to act as a buffer against the sharp edges of the forming block. Rather than tearing the expensive solid piece of rubber, we can improve its longevity by sacrificing the individual pieces of scrap inner tube. The inner tube material is also of lower durometer, which can help in the forming process where more fluid rubber is needed to form around the larger flanges. We have even experimented and found that using multiple layers of inner tube material will work in place of our large 2-inch rubber block. This, however, is a bit cumbersome and unpredictable. The process of hydroforming with this system is quite simple. Let's go through the individual steps. First, we will need to make up a die in the shape that we wish to form. The best results will come as a result of pre-manufacturing the parts that you're going to form with as little residual material as necessary. Ideally, you would like to be able to remove the part from the die and utilize it as is. We always create built-in positioning pins to hold the sheet metal to the forming block during the hydroforming process. Generally speaking, we would like to place the part as close to the center of the box as possible. This will allow for a very even distribution of pressure from the rubber forming block. Next, we're going to spray the part and the aluminum with lemon pledge to act as a lubricant. Following that, we're going to place some sacrificial rubber, usually 2 to 3 pieces, over the part to be formed. And then next, we'll place our 2-inch rubber block on top of the sacrificial rubber. Place the plunger over the rubber block, and now using the hydraulic press, force the plunger onto the rubber block to form the sheet metal to the shape of your die. The amount of pressure necessary will depend on the size and complexity of the part. But generally speaking, with a 20-ton hydraulic press, you're going to need to use every bit of the pressure available. We will then release the pressure on the hydraulic press, We will remove the plunger, remove the big rubber block, remove the sacrificial rubber, and it will reveal your completed part. And although these parts are beautiful, this whole process is not without difficulties. The development of a die using the forming process is at very least an art. Learning how to mold the die in such a way that you won't end up with cracks, wrinkles, takes a lot of trial and error. On simple parts, the learning process can be rather painless. However, on very large, complex parts with thick metals, things get a bit trickier. Developing ribs without the cutaways for the flanges are easily accomplished by using fluting pliers on the flanges. One of the tricks that we've learned is to use the fluting pliers to start a flute very simply before placing the metal onto the bending die so that we can force the flutes into a very specific location. Wrinkling of the aluminum during the forming process can be mitigated by strategically placing cutouts into the die. With a little trial and error, you will soon learn what you can and cannot get away with. Once you've built yourself one of these little hydroforming boxes, you will start coming up with all kinds of ideas on how you can use it. Even though you may have other ways of accomplishing the same type of task, this process really starts to shine when you have to make multiple parts that are identical to each other. So that's all there is to it. If you wish, you can go to our website and download a free set of plans for manufacturing your own hydroforming box. We'll put a link to the plans in the description below. Well, we've come to the end of this episode on low-cost hydroforming. We put a lot of effort into bringing you only high-quality, useful videos for the sport aviation market. If you enjoy what we're doing, please remember to like the videos. And if you want to stay up to date on all of the new videos that we create, please subscribe to our YouTube channel.